Hi, everybody, and welcome to Specimens. My name is Elle, and I am the host of this show where I talk with the stewards of conservation about all things specimens. If you haven't listened to an episode of this show before, the objective of this podcast is to shine a light on the work done by brilliant conservationists, researchers, and scientists that work in underrepresented or sometimes misunderstood roles within the science genre. And talking of underrepresented, today's guest is Leif Bersweden. He's a botanist, author, and nature communicator, and he's here to explain why we should take more notice of the weeds growing out of the cracks in the concrete, or even just the flowers in our garden that we're yet to identify and haven't really paid any attention to. I loved this macro lens look on specimens right under our noses, and Leif does such a wonderful job at communicating how fascinating they are. So get inspired and enjoy the episode. Leif, it's a pleasure to speak with you for my podcast. Thank you so much for giving up your time to speak with me.
Oh, thank you for having me.
Oh, it's an absolute pleasure. How are you and where are you?
I'm very well, thank you. I am in Oxford, where I live. For once, I seem to be travelling around the country a lot with everything I do. But yeah, so it's nice to be at home. Coming to you from Oxford.
Oh, fantastic. Okay, and I know that that's a beautiful part of the world. And for all our non-native listeners, you can give us a little snapshot of what that looks like. But before you do that, okay, I'd love for you to take me right back to the start. So I know from my research that botany has been well intertwined in your life for a very long time. But talk to me about when it all started for you. So when did you first start noticing the natural world and what did it look like back then?
So my interest in nature very much began, basically as long as I can remember. So I think it was my dad got me into nature first when I was sort of 4, 5, 6 years old. He took me bird watching in the winters and in the summer he made this like a sweep net. So he got this old sort of metal frame bent into a ring. There was an old bed sheet which formed the net and then like a broom handle stuck on the side of it. And we used to go out into the sort of long grass behind the house and sort of sweep it through this grass and collect all sorts of amazing like spiders and insects and things. And we would put them in little jam jars and we punctured holes in the top with like a screwdriver. And I've took them home to identify and then release these things back into the garden. And I just absolutely loved it. And as a kid, just became swiftly obsessed with anything that moved, particularly things like beetles, dragonflies, butterflies, and the birds. And yeah, just, you know, started actively sort of going outside and looking at these things for myself. But it was, I don't know, after a while, I always used to get so frustrated all the time, because as a kid I would just like without question just career after these things, just like run at them, and like all I wanted to do was have a good look, and of course they would always run away from me, and I was kind of left there, you know, age 6 or 7, just like why are they all running away from me? All I want to do is like give them some love and some time and attention. And that was incredibly frustrating, and so I was sort of left with all the plants in my feet, which obviously couldn't run away. And so from that point, I was kind of like, I mean, yeah, the fact that plants couldn't run away was by far and away the best thing about them. It was really exciting. So I was suddenly like, okay, here are some living things which can't run away from me. And I could actually spend that time, you know, staring at them for as long as I liked and actually getting to know them and form bonds with these different species in a way that I couldn't really do with the animals, certainly not at that stage, because they were terrified of me, perhaps rightly so, because I would just run after them. So that's how it all sort of started.
That's so fantastic. That is a really beautiful entry point to your passion. How did that then translate and become something a little bit more concrete? Did you always have the ambition to take that academically? Did you know from the start, I'm going to pursue this for a career? Or was there ever a point that you were thinking about doing something else with your life?
No, there was never really a point where I was like, I wanted to do something else. It was always, I spent all of my free time either playing football or looking at nature. And there was a period in my life where I was convinced I was going to be a Premier League football player. Okay. And you know, I'm 29 now, and I think, you know, there's still a few more years I could
never
still
say never.
Make it, maybe. Not quite too old, exactly. But yeah, no, it was always going to be nature, really. So at school, I was frustrated again by the lack of plants in like the biology syllabus. There was photosynthesis and stuff, but there was very little. But I was still determined that, you know, I discovered this world that was completely fascinating, and I wanted to spend as much time trying to learn about it as possible. And so, yeah, the idea was always to do something nature related. And I think back at the beginning, the dream was to be like a nature reserve warden or something. Just a job where I could spend a lot of time outside looking at nature, recording it, protecting it as best I could. And then as I went through sort of the education system, I got really into like the kind of like research side of it. And so decided after my degree to try and get into academia. So I spent 4 years doing a PhD on sort of wild orchid genetics, and very quickly realized that as fun as that was and as interesting as that was, my brain is just not cut out for like data analysis and research, and just
heavy,
exhausting. And so I was kind of like, you know, I was really pleased I'd done it, and I did genuinely really really enjoy that time, but I kind of figured my skills would be better put to use elsewhere. And so yeah, I quickly abandoned academia, but yeah, obviously I'm still very much working with nature, which is great fun.
I'm gonna just go right back to probably something quite simple and perhaps fairly silly, but I think it's really important to establish what the primary function of a botanist does, because your PhD thesis sounds very, very specialized. But I think it would be good to kind of relay in layman's terms to the listeners, perhaps what the primary function of a botanist is, and then therefore the different types of fields of study, or maybe the categorization within that, if it's not too broad at this stage.
Yeah, so I'm very glad you've asked that, because I'm not sure I could tell you an enormous about my PhD. I've sort of I've largely forgotten lots of it. So fundamentally, in my opinion, certainly, a botanist is simply someone who goes outside and pays attention to wild plants. Obviously, you can be a professional botanist and be sort of working with that, but you don't need to be this highly trained person. You can just be someone who literally goes outside and looks at, you know, dandelions growing out of pavement cracks. That's for me, that is something a botanist does. So it's this really, when it comes down to it, a really sort of basic thing. Obviously there are loads of different ways you can be a botanist. And I feel like I'm just in like a random niche part of that, but it's kind of this really broad subject, but yeah, fundamentally just comes down to looking at wild plants.
Okay. It's interesting that you use the word wild plant specifically, because I know I'm going to ask you a little bit about, I suppose, the opposite, which would be maybe like captive or like indoor.
Captive plants. I love it.
I know that that kind of does what it says on the tin, but that's probably not the right word, is it?
I know what you mean. So like house plants and garden plants. I mean, as you can see behind me, I have house plants. Mm. These plants that I keep captive in my house. I like the aesthetics of them. Of the house plants that I have, I reckon I could name maybe half of them. The others, I have no idea what they are. Couldn't even begin to tell you. Like some of these behind me, haven't got a clue. I like being surrounded by sort of a jungle of vegetation at all times, if possible.
Yeah. I don't blame you. I know this is a question that I had kind of lined up for later, because there's a lot of primary stuff I would love to knuckle down. But since we're on the topic, I kind of want to dig into that. So the boom in, as I call it, plant parenting has really seemed to have taken over in recent years, or at least seems that way from the outside. Obviously, I'm not in that sphere, but from kind of the Instagram accounts and the various monsteras you see, it seems like indoor plants have become really popular. And I wonder how you feel about that from a professional point of view. I know you said you love being surrounded by it and you might not necessarily be able to name all of them, but how do you feel about this? Because I know that as demand surges, this might raise ethical concerns. So things like importation and of non-natives, and then that potentially being detrimental to ecosystems we have in place already. That's something that ever comes up for you?
Not really, but I think...
Okay.
Yeah, I mean, obviously there are always going to be, there are going to be problems around things like the use of, say, peat and compost to grow these plants.
Right.
So whenever I have, on the odd occasion where I have bought houseplants, I've always made sure that they've been grown in compost that hasn't used peat, extracted from peat bogs. So yeah, there are a few things like that. In terms of like non-native species and invasiveness, I think garden plants, yeah, the outside captive plants are the ones where the potential, it's much more likely that invasive species will come through gardens and sort of escaping from gardens, I think, as far as I'm aware anyway, rather than the indoor ones. Because just because I think, you know, I suppose the only way the indoor plants are going to get out is if we sort of throw them away, which I suppose probably happens quite a bit. But yeah, I think the garden plants and those naturalizing and escaping from gardens is probably where the problem with invasiveness is gonna come from.
Okay, so let's get into that. Let's get into kind of the wild plants. With regard to wild plants specifically, what can that tell us about the health of an ecosystem? So if you're going outside and you're not seeing something, so there's an absence of something, what are we learning and what is that telling us about the strength and the health of that ecosystem?
Ooh, good question. Various different things have just popped into my head. Okay, so basically with human influence, obviously we end up...
Okay.
Destabilizing ecosystems, we end up unbalancing them, and this can obviously cause some plant species to disappear. Some disappear very quickly, and others will take advantage of that situation. And so a really good example would be silage fields, where you often get just one species, often perennial ryegrass, which just basically creates a monoculture and takes advantage of the destabilization, which in the case of silage fields is us basically spraying fertilizer on the fields, putting loads and loads of nutrients into the soil, which sounds like it's a really good thing for plants because obviously plants do need nutrients to grow, but actually to encourage high biodiversity we need really poor soils. So perennial ryegrass is one of these species that's really, really, really good at taking up nutrients. And so, yeah, it's basically able to just sort of hoover up all of that fertilizer that goes into the soil, grows really big, really quickly, and just outcompetes everything else.
Yeah.
So, that's a really good example of where you can tell that if there's just sort of one thing growing, that's a really good sign that there's something not normal going on, and that's something very unhealthy in that ecosystem, because naturally no one species should be able to dominate. It should be sort of like an even playing field with lots of things competing with each other. But then there are other things. There are species like orchids, for example, are really good indicators of really healthy ecosystems. So they are incredibly incredibly fussy, high maintenance plants. I'm sure if you've got any orchids, I can see one on your windowsill behind you actually. Yeah. You, although that one looks like it's doing very well.
Flourishing, but I feel as though it's probably feeling quite judged.
But yeah, as I'm sure any of your listeners who have orchids inside know, they can, yeah, just be incredibly fussy things. It's often quite hard to know what they actually want. But yeah, the same is true of our wild species as well. So these things, as soon as something isn't quite right, they will just disappear. And so the presence of orchids is a sign you've got a really healthy ecosystem. And then things like cowslips has just popped into my head. So basically cowslips are a very well-known plant that sort of traditionally grow in these like old hay meadow, wildflower meadows in kind of April, May time. And you can use them to actually give this sort of proxy measurement of how healthy the ecosystem is. So cowslips have two different types of flower. So one plant will have one type and another plant will have another type. They never mix within one plant. And the difference is simply at the center of the flower. So they've got these sort of yellow flowers that come together into sort of this almost like a bunch of keys at the top of the stem. It's called sort of this bundle of flowers. And yes, they've got five petals that are all fused together. And at the center of those yellow petals, there is the sort of reproductive parts of the flower. Okay. Now, in one flower type, you've got the female part of the flower, the stigma sticking up through that hole in the middle. And the male parts are sort of hidden halfway down the tube, the stamens. And in the other flower type, it's the other way around. So the stamens, the male parts are protruding from the top and the female part is halfway down. And this is basically, without going into that too much, but that's basically a way of ensuring these plants transfer pollen from one plant to another and they don't end up pollinating themselves, which is generally considered a bad thing. But you can use the ratio of those two flower types within a population to understand more about whether you're in this healthy ecosystem or not. Because it naturally it'd be a roughly 50-50 ratio between the two types. But as soon as something isn't quite right, so if, I don't know, if there are fertilizers sort of leaching into the soil from nearby farmland or something like that, then that ratio will sort of fall out of balance. So if you go around and you look at all the cowslips and you sort of tot up the numbers of each one and they're out of balance, they're out of that 50-50 ratio, then yeah, you know that something isn't quite as it should be.
It's really interesting. Evolution, as I'm sure that you would agree, is quite mind-blowing. And I think that there is this perception that plants specifically, and I guess you could tell me whether trees are categorized into that as well, but are intelligent. And I've heard that word, well, actually I've read that word being used within a scientific context in journals and various other written documentation. Now, I imagine the word intelligence there is subjective as to what parameters you're reading intelligence within. Do you consider plants intelligent? And if so, what and how would you define that?
Ooh, another really good question. Yeah, so yes, I absolutely do, but in a very different way to the way that we're intelligent. Okay. Obviously, plants don't have a big brain like we do. They aren't in the same way capable of, you know, all the amazing things that our brains do. But yeah, I do think that our definition of intelligence is obviously a very human-centric one.
Sure.
And I think that plants are absolutely intelligent, just in a very different way. So I think, you know, they've been around for so much longer than we have. The way I talk about it will inevitably be a very human way of talking about it, but they know things that we don't know. It's very difficult for us to sort of define that and learn about that because we're always going to be approaching it from a sort of human perspective. Mm-hmm. But yeah, you know, plants have the senses or proxies of the senses that we have. They're able to smell and feel and taste and touch and see in different ways, but they have those senses. They have those ways of interacting with the world in the same way that we do. They have way more senses than we do. And of course they can do it in the air as we're doing it, but also beneath the ground. And I think there's an awful lot that we can learn from plants. They have survived, you know, these huge mass extinctions. They have been around for hundreds of millions of years. They've adapted to all sorts of different niches around the world. They know how to like work with each other and like live this sort of reciprocal life. I think there's an awful lot we can learn from them. I think they are intelligent in a very different way.
Sure.
And definitely don't get enough credit for that.
That's what we're here for. That's what this episode's all about. Let's give them the credit they deserve. And in light of that answer that you just gave, I wonder if there's any specific processes that come into mind that maybe a regular person outside of the sphere of botany doesn't know about that are really awesome, fascinating. Something that a plant does that potentially has the capability to blow our minds.
Where do I start? Tell you what, okay, I will. It's an example I talk about quite a lot, but I do really love it. So this is a plant that I knew about already, but really discovered a couple of years ago. I was told about how it lives its life. Okay. It's a plant called Water Soldier. Water Soldier, as the name suggests, is an aquatic plant, and it basically likes to grow in ponds, ditches, sort of shallow lakes, that kind of thing.
Okay.
And from the side of the water, it just looks like the sort of top leaves of a pineapple sticking up through the surface of the water. Okay. And in the summer, they produce this small sort of three-petaled white flower. It just sort of sticks up through the surface. Now, when I was growing up, I never really thought much about how aquatic plants live their lives. I knew they existed. I'd seen them in old ponds and things in woodlands near where I lived. But yeah, I'd never once thought about how they managed to survive just in water all the time.
Yes.
And Water Soldier very much has this... has to face this problem, which a lot of freshwater aquatic plants have to face, which is seasonal ice. Oh. So obviously during the winter, these shallow water bodies that they live in like freeze over for a period of time. And if you're a plant and you've got your leaves at the surface of the water, then that's going to be really problematic if it freezes, because all that precious machinery that they build for harvesting sunlight just will get destroyed by ice. So Water Soldier has come up with this amazing way of dealing with that. It spends the whole summer floating at the top of the water, and its leaves, it's able to do that because its leaves are full of these like air pockets, which are like pumped full of air. So they're really, really buoyant, and they just sit there on the surface of the water, and their roots dangle down into like the silts at the bottom. And they spend the summer there. They, you know, make their own food from the sun. They get pollinated, do all their summer things. And then as it comes to the end of the summer, they start like breaking their leaves down.
Okay.
So in preparation for what's about to come. So basically within these leaves, these air pockets start collapsing one by one. And as they do so, they start filling with water. And so very slowly over the course of the autumn, this plant gets heavier and heavier and heavier. And so it very slowly sinks all the way down to the bottom of the pond. And of course, that means that when it freezes over during the winter, it's just sat at the bottom. It's completely submerged. The ice forms and actually insulates the plant. It protects it from all these like, cold sort of winter storms and things. And it literally just sits there for the whole winter, just sat biding its time in the silts at the bottom of the water. But then in the spring, and this is the really cool bit, in the spring, this plant grows new leaves. And obviously, because it's in a shallow water body, the light can reach the bottom of the water. And so these new leaves start photosynthesizing. And, you know, as a byproduct of that, they release oxygen. But instead of releasing that out into the air for us to breathe, they sort of pack it up, that oxygen, in the brand new air pockets within those leaves. And so very slowly, as the spring arrives, this plant gets more and more buoyant as it fills back up with air again, and very slowly sort of rises back up to the surface again. And so, and it's just mad. You've got this plant that spends its whole summer sat on the surface, and then it's like, oh, it's going to get cold, it's going to freeze. So it just sinks to the bottom, waits out that ice, and then just returns to the surface again to carry on it's doing. So I just love that. I just love that we have plants that do things like that. You know, so many people go through life just thinking plants are boring, but they haven't heard stories like that. And it's just, oh,
precisely.
Frustrates me enormously. But yeah, that's one of my favorites.
I love it. Plants are so much more, and like I used the word intelligent earlier, but I feel as though they're so much misunderstood. And I guess it kind of leads me to ask the question about the industry as a whole, and more specifically, whether or not you're seeing that this industry is still quite closed and the kind of barriers to access are still very much set in place, or you're seeing a resurgence of interest and a kind of growing and moving of goalposts. I think there is a historic connotation when you think of the word botanist, and I wonder if you have seen those barriers to entry and whether you can talk about how that might look at the moment as someone who's in the industry.
So I think most people, when they hear the word botanist, are probably going to think of, you know, I don't know, my image of it is like elderly people in a herbarium looking at very dusty specimens. And you know, there are groups of botanists like that, and they are full of knowledge, and I cannot express how wonderful they are. But that is not by any means what botany is as a whole. So I think there is, my impression is that there is a small resurgence. I think people are starting to appreciate the natural world and appreciate plants. I will emphasize the word small, because I think it's in the grand scheme of things, it is a very small number of people, but it's nice to see people starting to notice plants. And yeah, it may be within my sort of social media bubble that I'm seeing this, but I think people are starting to realize that plants aren't just these passive things which are part of the background, all look green, don't really move like animals do. And, you know, everything I do is trying to convince people that that is very much the case, that they are these incredible creatures that are really exciting. And, you know, we go through life learning that plants are boring. We're taught that plants are boring. You know, in society, we have this mindset that plants are boring. And that just acts as this barrier to learning about all the amazing stories that they have to tell, all the incredible ways in which they live their lives. And yeah, as someone who's grown up looking at plants and you know, getting so much joy and excitement from them, that idea that plants are boring just doesn't tally with anything that I've experienced. And so, yeah, I'm just trying to do everything I can to try and open up that world to people a bit more. And you know, it is, I can see how it is slightly more inaccessible, because obviously plants don't have eyes, they don't have faces, they're much harder in a way to relate to than animals are. So as well as sharing their stories, I also try to share some of the ways in which I engage with plants and interact with them, which is everything from, you know, getting into the water and getting sort of face to flower with these things, all the way through to simply just getting down on the ground and looking at plants from plant height rather than head height. Yeah, so it's in a sense, it's frustrating, because I know that a lot of people think botany is this boring thing. But at the same time, it just means there's lots of potential there for convincing people. And I know people get excited about it, because you tell them stories and they're like, no way, I can't believe plants do that. So yeah, There's a lot of work to be done, but I'm convinced that it'll work.
Well, Leif, you're doing a wonderful job. I mean, I was very excited to speak with you, having found your Instagram and the way that you photograph the work, the specimens kind of from a macro level, because again, it's one of those things that we just take for granted. It's right under our nose, but yet we're seeing, but we're not really looking, if that makes sense. So I think you do a great job at shining a light on.
Thank you.
Oh, my pleasure. I think it's relevant to the answer that you just gave. But in light of the climate crisis, obviously, we're hearing a lot of the bad. We don't really get visibility on the success stories and the conservation success of plants. Do you know of, or can you share any stories of conservation resurrection of, I don't know, species that might have been thought to be extinct that were rediscovered, or anything that is a positive story that gives plants visibility that we might not see in the mainstream? I put you on the spot a little bit.
Yeah, just trying to think of, I mean, there are various examples of plants that have been rediscovered. So for example, and this was a while ago, but there's a species called the military orchid, which is this fantastic thing that is sort of this pinky purple grayish color. And it produces these flowers that look like little people. So they've got arms, they've got legs, they've got a little hat. And supposedly they look like a little soldier with like a grayish helmet and like trench coat buttons down its front.
So good. Can't wait to
I think it looks like it's wearing pajamas, but I think the pajama orchid might have been a better name for it. But it was basically, it was so sought after during the sort of Victorian period, where people were like obsessed with orchids and collecting, that it was collected to extinction within this country. Mm-hmm. And I can't remember how long it was, but certainly sort of decades went past without anyone finding any. And then in 1950, this botanist called Ted Loosley found, he was on a family picnic.
Oh, yeah.
In the Chilterns. And while everyone else was eating or like sitting around in the sunshine afterwards, he just sort of went for a little walk while they were finishing up and just to see what he could find. And he walked through this wood and came across this sort of glade in this woodland that was full of military orchids. Wow. No one had seen any for decades within Britain. And yeah, he kept it this really closely guarded secret for years. But it's now they've opened up different clearings near it and it's spread into those as well. So it's doing really, really well. And so I can't remember when it was, but basically at some point they told the public, and it's now this lovely little nature reserve in the Chilterns. It's still massively restricted nationwide. It's a very, very rare plant, but it does seem quite happy. Awesome. Just growing in these little woodland glades. Sounds very sort of magical, like from a fairy tale.
Oh, I would love to visit. I mean, you're talking about the Chilterns and now we're kind of getting back into British territory a little bit more. So I'd love to give you the opportunity to talk about your book, Where the Wildflowers Grow. And in fact, I won't even try and give a bio. I'll let you tell me everything about it, from what was the impetus behind writing it and the whole journey that it took you on.
Yeah, so Where the Wildflowers Grow, it basically came from this, again, another frustration growing up. when I was trying to convince people that plants are really interesting, I sort of realized that there was no real sort of bridge between any initial engagement with the world of botany, be it through social media or some talk or something, mm-hmm. And the next step, which was the identification guides.
Okay.
And as much as I love those books, they're just, you know, packed full of Latin names and botanical jargon and keys and an overwhelming number of species. And I was just convinced that anyone who sort of got any initial excitement about botany from social media or something would then go and look at those and be like, oh, actually it's too much, I can't do it. Mm-hmm. So I wanted to write something that yeah, would act as a bridge between the two, that would act as like a gateway, if you like, into the world of British and Irish plants. And so, yeah, I went on this big adventure around the country on my bike, well, with the help of a lot of trains as well. But yeah, sort of it was like a journey through the season. So I started on the 1st of January and worked my way all the way through the seasons, all the way around the country, all the way through to New Year's Eve. So it was like, Yeah, it's one calendar year. Mm-hmm. Just to try and like summarize as best I could, 1 year of British botany, all the exciting things you can find, all the amazing people who are part of it. And so as I went around, you know, I visited different habitats around the country and sort of looked for the plants that defined those places, really focusing on the common things which anyone can go and find. There were a few rare things that I came across as well, which is always very exciting. And loads of like really, really cool plants that just do weird and wacky things, like the water soldier. That just, yeah, these plants that I'm convinced people, you know, if people just heard these stories, they'd be like, actually, yeah, plants are actually quite interesting. So I went to look for those. And yeah, along the way, basically went plant hunting with people who had some kind of connection to their local flora and just chatted to them about why they like looking for wildflowers. And there was a real range of people, from like people who wouldn't even call themselves botanists, just mm-hmm. who appreciate the plants, in the places where they walk, all the way through to, you know, professional botanists who could name the exact hair on a particular leaf of a particular plant. And yeah, just some absolutely wonderful people, in the book, really, really, really lovely and really, really know their plants. And so it was really interesting to get this insight into why we love plants. For so many different reasons. As I said before, just ways to engage with them and interact with them. So it's this big year of looking for plants. It was basically just an excuse for me to be outside looking at plants all year.
Well, it came to a beautiful fruition. And for people who haven't yet read the book, though, I'm sure everyone will be going out, and don't worry, I'll be plugging.
Thank you.
But anyway, so for those people who haven't already read the book, can you give us kind of like a accessible crash course on what we should be doing if we want to get more connected to the outdoors in our own lives? We want to start taking an interest, but we wouldn't really know where to start. What would be the best and most accessible steps for the regular person to start connecting more to the plants and flowers around them?
So the advice I usually give people is kind of twofold. So if you are lucky enough to have a garden, then one of the simplest things you can do is just to let the lawn grow. So particularly from March, April onwards, to let the lawn grow, let everything, come up, flower. Because, you know, sometimes lawns are incredibly rich. They can be incredibly rich. And if they've just been mown year after year after year with no idea, you know, of what's underneath, suddenly you can get all these incredible things coming up. So that's like a really easy thing to do because it's literally involves less than you would normally be doing. But if you don't have a lawn, like, one of my favorite things to do, and it sounds bizarre, but is to look at all the plants in the cracks in the pavement and in the walls. Every time I go to the supermarket along my street, there's like, I think last year I counted 40 something species just growing. And it takes me about 5-10 minutes to walk to the supermarket just down this road. So yeah, there's, when you start looking, there's all sorts of things that have hopefully escaped weed killers and things, these tiny worlds. And yeah, it might take a little bit just to get over that like initial embarrassment at stopping and staring at a wall, but it's so rewarding. And also, like, you know, if anyone comes up and says, what are you doing, you can just, it's a good opportunity to talk about nature and plants and things. But I will regularly spend, you know, 5-10 minutes just looking at a wall and all the incredible things that are living in there. But yeah, so they're two of the like most simple things you can do literally on your doorstep.
That's great advice. I think it makes it a lot less intimidating, because we talked a little bit about that kind of historic feel. And I think it's great to hear from you that we can just get connected. Leif, from your professional position in the field, where do you think the future of botany is headed? I know you talked about social media seeing a small resurgence, but do you see a lot of conservation projects being lobbied for at a political level, or any projects at a local level that are starting to really take off in light of perhaps changes to our climate? You can be honest.
I will. Okay, good. I have absolutely no faith in the government whatsoever. You know, they talk all this talk and do absolutely nothing. Uh-huh. And often what they're doing is actively detrimental for nature. There are lots of like smaller scale community projects that I'm aware of that are doing amazing things. So for example, the first one which pops into my mind is a project called Sea Wilding, which is up on the west coast of Scotland. And it's literally this small community that's decided to do this nature conservation themselves. And so they work to bring back seagrasses, okay, which until very recently I thought were actual grasses, but they're not. They're a completely different family of flowering plants. They look like grasses. They've adapted to like living in the sea and having to deal with like waves and stuff, so they look like grasses, but no, they're completely different. And the actual name of the species that they're working on is eelgrass. And yeah, they have basically this sea lock that they live on is, I can't remember what percentage, but it used to be like this huge percentage of underwater meadow full of seagrasses, which have, you know, for various reasons disappeared over the years. You know, dredging, a lot of fishing, pollution, that sort of thing has sort of decimated these meadows, and they are working to bring them back. And I'm going to visit them in a few weeks' time. I'm very excited to go snorkeling and see these underwater meadows of, you know, flowering plants just living in the sea, which is just mad, because you never associate flowers with being underwater,
the ocean.
Yeah, exactly. So yeah, there are these excellent small projects, but on the large scale, certainly not enough is being done. And I think that's a big part of the responsibility comes down to the government for that.
Mm-hmm. Absolutely. And I feel that's a conversation for a whole another time. I'm sure we could do a whole hour just on that. I mean, Leif, there's so many things that I haven't spoken to you about that I would like to. And you've talked so much about how wonderful plants are, and I feel as though I haven't even given the plants much airtime. There are probably so many different adaptations and behaviors that you could tell me about, so I'll definitely have to have you back. I do have a very quick rapid fire that I'd love to do with you. Just want you to say yes or no, don't overthink it. It's just a bit of fun. No pressure. And I think it just gives a really nice picture of you as a person as well.
Okay,
so we're going to go for it. Yes or no?
Okay.
Mowing lawns?
No.
Foraging?
Yes.
Petrol station flowers?
Yes. Oh, wait, would you mean like the ones in the... I thought you meant the ones growing in the nice bit of grass around the side of the petrol station.
That's a true said from a true botany.
Okay.
The ones that are cut in cellophane.
Okay, no, absolutely not.
Bonsai trees.
Yes.
Ooh, that was hesitation. I think I know the answer to this one. Artificial grass.
Absolutely no way. I had to try really hard not to swear there.
Playing music to plants.
Yeah, why not? Yeah.
Composting.
Yes.
Edible flowers.
Yes.
Venus flytraps.
Yes.
Wild swimming.
Yes.
And botanical gin.
Ooh, yes. Absolutely.
Leif, it's been such a pleasure. I feel as though I could happily speak to you for a very long time, good. And I would love to have you back. But I know you're a busy man, so I'll thank you for your time and thank you so much for being on my podcast.
Oh, thank you very much for inviting me. It's been really fun.
So that concludes my episode with Leif Bersweden. I really enjoyed speaking with Leif, and I hope you enjoyed that episode too. I hope that maybe it made you think a little harder and perhaps consider to stand a little longer with the specimens in your own back garden or even on the sidewalk. If you want to find Leif, which you absolutely do because we talked about his macro photography and it is so beautiful and inspiring, you can find him on all social media platforms at Leif Bersweden. And if you are unsure, check the show notes because all the links are in there. And he also has a YouTube channel. That's Leif Bersweden 9442. So have a look at that. He's got some fantastic videos going into detail. He's also got information in his link tree about courses he's running and, of course, links to buy his phenomenal book. So find him, follow him, and I'll see you next time.